Move over, Sid Meier's Pirates, there's a new favorite pirate game in town. And that is, of course, Skies of Arcadia Legends. Skies of Arcadia wowed me with its setting, character writing, especially with its three main protagonists, battle systems, and exploration emphasis. The game remains a classic, and it is a huge shame it is not more readily available to players, because I have a little doubt that we have been missing out by leaving this game on defunct consoles. And I'm gonna tell you why you should play Skies of Arcadia. Skies of Arcadia is a turn-based combat JRPG with some sections resembling open-world games as well. The game was developed by Overworks and published by Sega, originally for Sega's own console, the Sega Dreamcast. It came out in 2000 for Japan and North America, and 2001 for Europe. After Sega left the console market, one of the first ports of their games they made was Skies of Arcadia Legends for the GameCube in 2002 for Japan and 2003 for North America and Europe. There was also a PlayStation 2 port planned, but that was cancelled, much like the Windows port announced in 2004 that never came to fruition. Both the Dreamcast original and the GameCube slightly modified port received critical acclaim for their story, setting, and combat, but sales numbers were not as rosy, which may explain the numerous cancelled ports and Sega passing up on a potential sequel. Since 2003, Skies of Arcadia has languished on the GameCube and Dreamcast despite interest from the original developers to bring it to modern consoles or create a sequel. Its fate lies in Sega's hands, but the most we've gotten has been a cameo for the main characters in Valkyria Chronicles. We can hope it happens at some point, but for now, if you can find a way to play Skies of Arcadia Legends, I recommend it because the game holds up impressively well for its age. Let's get into what Skies of Arcadia is about. The game takes place in Arcadia, which is basically an ocean of clouds with quite a few floating islands and continents with civilizations on each of the continents and towns or something on the islands. Each of these continents and civilizations identifies with one of the six colored moons that hover over Arcadia, and they draw power from these moons. Literally so when it comes to their ships, which are powered by moonstones. The game's hero is Vice, son of the leader of a band of air pirates who fights alongside the crew with his best friend Ika. The pirates of Skies of Arcadia are divided into two groups. The Blue Rogues, whom Vice and Ika are a part of, target the military ships of the Valuan Empire and have Robin Hood outlooks towards piracy. The Black Pirates, on the other hand, are more ruthless, taking on anyone they think they can get money out of. At the start of the game, the Blue Rogues attack a Valuan military ship that had just captured an unusual girl flying in the sky. Vice and Ika help capture the ship and rescue the girl, who introduces herself as Fina. The Valuan Empire, though, is hell-bent on recapturing Fina and discovering what she knows, leading to them attacking the pirates' home base of Pirate Isle. Vice and Ika then pull off a daring rescue of their fellow crew members and Fina once again, gaining her trust. Vice and Ika then decide to help Fina accomplish her mission to prevent Valua from gathering the six moon crystals and taking over the world. Their journey is full of adventure, colorful characters that can be recruited for their crew, danger, and discovering more about the world of Arcadia and its history. While the story itself is not likely to surprise anyone who is a veteran of the JRPG genre, I think there is quite a lot to interest any fans when it comes to the setting and world building. The way Skies of Arcadia doles out its history and details entices players to look for more and think about what it means to the people living today in Arcadia. I really like the writing of the game, despite the occasional missteps, which probably started out bad and aged even worse. But thankfully, those moments are few and far between. The real highlight when it comes to the game's writing is the character writing, specifically for its three leads. Vice, Ika, and Fina are excellent characters, and their bonds with each other are both believable and charming. I especially love the friendship between Vice and Ika and how secure they are with each other, avoiding a lot of the unnecessary drama found between leads in other games. It was quite frankly refreshing to have such strong friendships be a cornerstone of the game's writing, especially with a pair of opposite-sex best friends, which is rarely seen in any media that doesn't eventually lead into a couple. Thankfully, this trend of good character writing also extends to quite a few of the supporting cast, both for and against the heroes, which definitely made the game more memorable overall. As for combat, the game has random encounters for enemies in dungeons and out while exploring in your ship. Thankfully, they toned down the encounter rate from the Dreamcast version for Legends and upped the experience you get from enemies to make the game more enjoyable. After combat is initiated, you go into the battle screen with the enemies and up to four members of your party. You choose all of your party's actions for each turn at the start, and then see it play out along with all the enemy's actions as well. You can choose to do a standard attack, cast magic, perform a super move, use an item, focus to gain more spirit points, guard, or run away. For regular attacks, there is a chance both for your enemies and allies to do a counterattack afterwards, which is a stat you can improve with equipment. At the top of the screen, you have the party's spirit points, which are used up when casting magic or performing a super move and generate new points every turn. Thus, SP management is a crucial aspect of combat, especially for longer combat encounters and boss battles. On the other hand, keeping your party's HP and MP up is a lot easier because the game is very generous with the funds you get that you can then use to keep you in the good stuff when it comes to items. I highly recommend using items as much as possible for healing because you have an abundance of those items and they don't use SP and MP like casting heal spells do. Finally, when you are attacking, you can set your weapons to one of the six elemental colors once you've gotten stones for each color to use. Correspondingly, enemies have a color type that is weak or strong against certain colors, so you'll want to switch your weapon colors in combat to take advantage of enemy weaknesses. It is not a straightforward system though, so until you've memorized the color strengths and weaknesses, I recommend using a chart. Here is the one I use, credit to Emerald Demond for creating it. The weapon color you use in combat is also important because it determines which color upgrades from magic experience after combat, which is how you get new spells. Experience is generous though, so I at least didn't feel the need to grind for particular magical abilities or regular levels throughout the game. This combat style is mainly found during your dungeon exploration, although you can have battles on your ship while you're traveling around as well. These dungeons also offer a few unique challenges, usually in the form of puzzles. Not extensive ones, but they are there to give you a bit of a think before proceeding onwards. Other than shops, these dungeons are where you get powerful items and weapons, as well as stuff like moonberries which are necessary to unlock the highly useful super moves. I recommend doing a thorough exploration of all of the dungeon areas to make sure you collect all the chests and items before proceeding onwards. Otherwise, the dungeons function as expected, right down to that save point right at the end, spoiling that the boss fight is right behind that door. Most of your combat encounters will be as I described before, with your party against the enemies, but there are a few ship-to-ship combat encounters that work slightly differently. In these encounters, you get 4 moves to select for each round. The standard attack is replaced by various cannons you place on your ship. You can change them around once you've bought or earned new cannons, which require a certain amount of SP to fire. Items, magic, guard, and focus all carry over to ship combat, and the only other difference is the super move cannon that replaces the super move skills in regular combat. This cannon does an immense amount of damage, but can only be fired on certain turns, and so you need to time it up so you have enough SP to fire it when the time comes. The game helps you with this by giving you a preview of the next round so you have more information with which to make good tactical decisions. There is one last addition to this combat. Once you get to recruit crew members, they can add in sailor abilities that cost SP to use. Honestly, I never used them by that point, but it's there if you want more options. Like with regular combat, the enemy ship will also select 4 actions to attack and counter you, although the battle screen gives you a clue as to what they are preparing to do with the red, yellow, and green colored icons on top of your action select screen. This is highly useful because some of these attacks are gonna do a whopping load of damage, and you better be prepared for them. As with regular combat, SP management is the key to victory in ship combat. Time your attacks, evasive maneuvers, and repairs just right, and you will soar away to fly another day. Exploration is another big part of the game's side content. Around Arcadia, there are many floating wonders and curiosities that you can find and then report back to the Sailors Guild for money. The Sailors Guild also has a wanted list of notorious black pirates terrorizing the skies that Vice and crew can take on for some additional money. Finally, there are a few side quests, with 2 of them being important enough that I recommend all players finish them. Both of these quests are exclusive to the Legends version of the game. The first is the Moonfish quest, where a traveling doctor tasks you with finding moonfish for the strange bird that his adopted niece has grown attached to. You find these moonfish through a sharp ringing sound that happens when you get close to one, and then you can capture them by going into first person mode and shooting a grapple shot at them. The second side quest I recommend you complete is the Angel of Death side quest, where you take on a girl calling herself the Angel of Death and swearing revenge on all pirates. The game isn't full to bursting with side content, but what's there is fun and well incentivized either via money like the discoveries and bounties, or important revelations like the aforementioned side quests. Finally, there is a system in place called the Swashbuckler Rating for Vice that tracks certain things you do over the course of the game. Mainly this comes up with the dialogue options you have throughout the game that give you points if you say the correct answer or are properly heroic in your choices. Otherwise, the only other thing that modifies your rating is fighting battles and or running away from them. Fighting gives you points, running loses you points. Now, this system has no real bearing on the gameplay or really anything, but some stores, especially on Sailor's Island, will refer to Vice by his full earned Swashbuckler title. It's nice world building and setting that feels good going from store owners dismissing Vice at first to being in awe of him, and thus you, by the end of the game. Now, presentation-wise, the game looks pretty nice to me, if a bit sparse on details. The characters in particular are memorable, although I do wish similar attention had been given to the environments, which are more of a mixed bag, especially in the dungeons. The UI is also mostly good, with easy-to-follow menus in and out of combat. The only critique I have comes with the rather small map you can bring up that's hard to gauge distance and limited in what locations are put on it. The art, though, is quite nice in my opinion, and the animation in and out of battle is surprisingly fluid. On the topic of animation, one of the things I really enjoyed about the game was the background animation during combat. In a combat encounter with multiple enemies, as your characters are performing actions, you'll see other enemies and allies moving around behind them in sort of mock battle. It gives the battles a more dynamic feel, and I wish more turn-based combat games did something like that. Musically, the game has a very energetic soundtrack, which is appropriate given the adventurous feel of the game. The soundtrack does have flexibility, though, to slow down and be more serene or thoughtful at times, so I think the music really suits the tone and style of the game. Lastly, there is a tiny amount of voice acting in the game, mostly limited to in-game move announcements, but there is the occasional word or noise from characters during dialogue. Think the single words or noises from Fire Emblem Awakening dialogue, but only said once every full conversation. Odd choice in my opinion, and doesn't add much to the already limited character voices. The presentation for the game is solid for the age of the game, with only a few head-scratchers like how Ika's hair defies gravity like that. Does she have bottles on the side of her head covered by the hair? A mystery we may never solve. If you are feeling nostalgic for an older RPG and have either the money to get the game and console or the wherewithal to find another way to play the game, I highly recommend Skies of Arcadia, the Legends port specifically, as a game that can scratch that itch no problem. There is not another game like it before or since when it comes to its blend of combat, setting, and characters, and therefore it is a shame more people haven't gotten the chance to play it. I hope my video has been able to pique your interest or reinforce your desire to play the game, and maybe if we all continue lobbying Sega, they'll decide they should make it available to people who don't want to pay a secondhand seller $200. If you enjoyed my video, please leave it a like, comment, and or share in order to help the video and channel dodge the cyclones of the YouTube algorithm. Subscribe to keep up with the channel, and I hope to see you all in the next video. Have a great day, and happy gaming.